There's really no finer pathologist than the pathologist you're going to meet today, Dr. Beth Mapow, who is kind of my, you know, she's got a great team that she works with, but she, when it comes to peritoneal surface malignancy, she's my go-to. And hence, she's the go-to for a presentation today, talking about, you know, how do we classify appendiceal cancer, pseudomyxoma, peritonei? You know, just as an side note, you know, when we're preparing for this conference, I went to Beth and I said, you know, Beth, we have our third conference coming up. And this was, and this takes a long time to put these conferences together. And she looked at me quizzically and said, well, I'm giving birth right around that time. And I didn't say anything. And I just said, what about my conference? The symposium, how, you know, whatever. So, you know, she's poor planning. She's 7 weeks. She's in maternity leave right now. Her son, Lane, doing great. I've been getting pictures from everybody. But, you know, she's coming back on May 7th. So everybody wants to know she'll be back on May 7th. But she's here today. I am privileged to have her today. And can you make some sense out of the misclassifications or the classifications? Because, you know, we need some answers. Speak the truth. Dr. Beth Mapow.
Well, I'm going to try. First, I guess I have to thank the dragon for the introduction. You're so making that stick. Okay, so first of all, I promise I'm not going to teach you how to read everything in pathology this morning. I have no disclosures. Our goals, basically, for this presentation are really just going to be to review some of the classification systems, and actually I'm going to focus on the currently accepted classification. Look at some of the difficult areas in diagnostic criteria, and then summarize some of our challenges with reporting. So first of all, what is the appendix, right? So the appendix is this blind tube that's connected to the cecum, typically very small, and thought for a long time not to have any function. Some still think that there's no function whatsoever, but theoretically serves as a floral reserve for bacteria and also some immune and lymphatic functions. Important thing to know about the appendix is that the muscularis mucosa, which is a very important area for distinguishing invasion in a lot of areas, is not continuous in the appendix. It's continuous in the colon and a lot of other places, but in the appendix itself, it's not a continuous layer, which leads to a lot of diagnostic difficulties, especially for pathologists that are not accustomed to examining these specimens. So appendiceal neoplasia. In order to assess completely any neoplastic process that comes from the appendix, we really need all of these things. So we need to have a very good medical history on the patient, physical examination, imaging, complete exploration with examination of the whole peritoneal cavity, pathologic examination of the primary appendiceal tumor, which we often don't have, and then examination of lymph nodes. If peritoneal disease is present, we also need sampling from multiple areas in the peritoneum. So the first thing to understand is that the majority of the times that we're dealing with pseudomyxoma cases and these appendiceal tumors, we don't have the majority of this. The presentation of these tumors can be very subtle. Patients often will present at centers that are not accustomed to dealing with this. They don't have any dragons. so we really don't have all of these things the majority of the time when we're examining these specimens, and that by itself really affects our ability to make an accurate and complete diagnosis. So there is a huge spectrum of tumors that are kind of occur in the appendix, and that ranges from an adenoma all the way to carcinoma. We're not going to talk about really anything except for the mucin-producing lesions today, because I'm going to do my very best to stay on time. So they come in two varieties, really, low-grade and high-grade tumors. The low-grade is the most debated, certainly amongst even people that see these cases a lot. High-grade is going to be the most agreed upon. And the majority of the problem with examination of these specimens has been the fact that there have been really numerous classification systems that have been proposed and used in different centers, which creates the problem of pathologists have varying exposure to the different classification systems, as do the surgeons have varying exposure. So this by itself creates interpretation difficulties, and then obviously lots of frustration for patients because they have a tumor called one thing in one place and maybe another thing when you have your case reviewed elsewhere. So these are the classification systems. I'm not going to go over all of this because it would take much longer than what we have, but certainly want to focus more on the WHO or World Health Organization classification. That really is the best accepted terminology, and I think that, you know, hopefully we can find much more consistency with pathologic reporting if everybody follows the WHO classification. So for our low-grade appendiceal mucinous neoplasms, they commonly present with abdominal mass or ovarian mass, or often patients will present with metastasis, which creates really lots of diagnostic difficulties. Our gross or external examination of the appendix, we sometimes can see a completely normal-looking appendix. Sometimes the appendix itself is really just a little bit dilated, but externally looks fairly normal. Now, for, you know, some patients, certainly with more advanced disease, what we're going to see is rupture of that appendix with mucin spread on the surface. And then sometimes with patients that are even further along, there really is nothing left of the appendix at all, which certainly prevents the pathologist from doing an examination of the primary appendiceal tumor and causes lots of issues with it as far as interpretation. Histologically or under the microscope, what we see is, you know, varying from either a villous projection or a very flat neoplastic epithelium, which produces lots of mucin. The cells themselves will have abundant intracellular mucin. And then one of the biggest problems with these tumors is that they invade the tissue by this pushing invasion. And again, this is really difficult to diagnose, especially because our muscularis is not completely continuous in that appendix. So that by itself, that pushing invasion can be very difficult, especially for non-experienced pathologists to interpret. Cells themselves usually only show mild nuclear atypia, and this is really what created a lot of the classification systems that people used for years, where they didn't feel that this was actually cancer. You know, these cells, even though they were disseminated elsewhere, were not really considered as severely by pathologists because they really don't have the amount of atypia that we see in the majority of malignant lesions. And you can also see some fibrosis in the wall. Okay, so diagnostic difficulty. So I talked about this a little, or at least alluded to this pushing invasion. And again, the fact that the muscularis there is not continuous, the tumor itself pushes easily into the wall. Now, since there's really not a tissue response from that invasion into the tissue, it's very, very easy for people to misinterpret that as a non-invasive process. And again, this is what leads to really diagnostic discrepancies between different centers and between different pathologists. Sometimes, especially with an advanced tumor, the wall itself may be entirely breached. And if we have that, then it's really, really difficult to establish invasion when we're looking at it under the microscope, because we really do rely upon having those histologic structures there to actually make a diagnosis. So these are just images showing you the pushing invasion. And again, all it really looks like is a fistula tract, right? So it looks like, you know, the tissue itself just kind of left. Well, it didn't leave. The tumor itself invaded through the tissue. It doesn't cause the typical response that most pathologists are looking for when we're talking about an invasion lesion. So again, this is a significant problem in these lesions. And it's why, you know, Dr. Richard talked about going to centers where your surgeons and people are experienced. It's really equally important to go to a center where the pathologist is experienced in looking at these lesions, because they are really difficult to interpret and can be easily misinterpreted as a non-invasive process. Okay, so other problem is going to be distinguishing from mucinous carcinoma. So histologically, so under the microscope, they can actually look exactly the same. We really are going to rely upon that pushing invasion for diagnosis, as well as peritoneal dissemination. However, we have a second problem with, even under the current 8th edition AJCC, there's still debate about peritoneal dissemination. You know, what we actually classify that as when we look at it. So the appendiceal tumor really can either be diagnosed as, you know, a low-grade mucinous lesion with peritoneal involvement, or a mucinous adenocarcinoma. Certainly here at the center, and when I'm looking at cases, I certainly prefer mucinous adenocarcinoma given the potential for these lesions. High-grade appendiceal mucinous lesions are a little bit of a different animal. Histologically, they meet the entire criteria for your low-grade mucinous lesions, but what we see cytologically is that those cells themselves look much worse. So, you know, they have lots of cytologic atypia. I could throw lots of words out that you don't want to hear, but, you know, they definitely show much more atypia than what we see in the low-grade lesions. Whenever we see that, we really should be using the staging system for invasive carcinomas, even if that's only focally present in the tumor. Again, this is another thing that, you know, pathologists in centers where they're not seeing a lot of cases are going to struggle with, because focal changes in the majority of tumors as pathologists usually don't define the entire lesion. However, for these lesions themselves, significant cytologic atypia, even if focal, really should be considered a high-grade lesion and should be treated and followed more aggressively. So adenocarcinoma, so again, once we get to this stage of classification, then we only have a couple of choices for these lesions. So adenocarcinoma, not otherwise specified, or NOS. Mucinous adenocarcinoma, and the lesion needs to be greater than 50% mucinous. That's going to be the majority of these lesions that we're talking about, which are going to be predominantly mucinous. Our other choices, signet ring cell adenocarcinomas. Some of our high-grade mucinous lesions are going to have signet ring cells. If there's a significant amount of signet ring cells in that tumor, it should be considered straight signet ring cell adenocarcinoma, because that's the exact behavior and biology that that tumor is going to follow. And then also we have patients that present with non-mucinous adenocarcinomas in the appendix, and these are going to be our colorectal type tumors, which are going to, again, follow a much more colorectal type process. So for our mucinous adenocarcinomas, again, this is typically what we're going to be talking about for our pseudomyxoma cases. Grossly, peritoneal disease is really often going to be present. Histologically, we're going to see clear invasion into the wall, which typically has rupture. We can also see hematogenous dissemination. And again, our peritoneal disease in these tumors tends to have more cellularity. Sometimes in our lower grade lesions that have disseminated, what we'll actually see as pathologists are really just pools of mucin in the peritoneum that don't have any cells. If I have that and there's no cells, then I can't consider that really disease. But if I have cells, then it's a different story. So this is an example, again, of peritoneal dissemination of adenocarcinoma. You can see that those pools, or what looks like clear spaces in the middle of the pink stuff, is all going to be mucin pools, and that's all lined by cells in all of those spaces. So, again, our diagnostic difficulties, really, so distinguishing adenocarcinoma from a low-grade mucinous neoplasm. Again, what we really need to see is our infiltrative growth pattern, so where it actually is invading into that tissue. Often it's easier to diagnose if we see some single cells. You may or may not have desmoplasia, and what that means is a stromal response to that tumor. Stromal response happens in the majority of lesions. It doesn't happen most of the time for these low-grade mucinous lesions. But if present, then there's no pathologist that's going to miss invasion. And then distinguishing from metastasis, and sometimes this really is the majority of our job as pathologists, because patients will present with late-stage disease. So they may have a little bit of complaint. Surgeon, dragon, takes them to the OR, finds disseminated disease everywhere, sends us a specimen, you know, for frozen section diagnosis, and what we see is a mucin-producing tumor that's in the peritoneum. Well, at that point, as pathologists, our job is to make sure of where that tumor came from. So we need to distinguish it from all tumors that can produce mucin. So in those cases, we often have to do immunostains to try to differentiate where the primary is. Even immunostains by themselves are not going to be 100% diagnostic. It really relies on good surgeons to make sure that they're looking for an appendix, give us the history of the appendix, a primary tumor if it's there, sampling from multiple areas. All of these things are going to make it easier for us to not make a mistake. So for the AJCC staging, so we are on the 8th edition. So the 8th edition actually had a lot of improvements from prior systems. So again, we shouldn't have as much discrepancy with staging between pathologists at different centers now with the 8th edition, because it clearly states that you can have an in situ carcinoma, but your T1 and T2 tumors do not apply to low-grade appendiceal mucinous lesions. So again, we're not going to have that those errors popping up on pathology reports, because the 8th edition really can take care of that. So, you know, we're really going to either have an in situ tumor, or we're going to have a T3 tumor, which invades through the muscularis into the subserosa, and then again, or higher. So pseudomyxoma, so we've talked about it, you know, you've seen photos of it, and certainly lots of you are very familiar. So pseudomyxoma characterized by mucinous ascites and peritoneal implants. Generally, these originate from peritoneal spread from low-grade appendiceal mucinous lesions or mucinous adenocarcinomas. Again, my preferred terminology, especially if there's cells there, is going to be the mucinous adenocarcinoma. And the morphology tends to correlate with the invasiveness of the primary tumor. So if we have peritoneal disease that has high-grade cytologic ectopia in it, that's going to be a bad-acting tumor and typically correlates with a clearly invasive lesion. Staging system for peritoneal disease, again, so, you know, we have a better staging system, so, you know, discrepancies between pathology reports really aren't going to be there that much. Certainly, your metastasis includes intraperitoneal mucin and also includes no tumor cells, although in one, the higher stages don't. And then summary. So I think I've covered all of this, but so determining your invasion is really going to be an important thing. So it's difficult for pathologists, patients that are going to centers where a pathologist maybe only sees one case a year, or maybe they've never even seen. That's one thing to know. It is possible to have a pathologist that's actually never seen in practice a case of pseudomyxoma or a case of an appendiceal mucinous lesion. So in looking at a case like that, it's very difficult for them to make the correct interpretation of a case. You know, at larger centers where people are seeing lots of cases, again, we're familiar with looking for the invasion, how that invasion looks, and being able to do correct staging. Histologic grading, again, is another issue, because any area with high-grade cytologic ectopia is really going to speak to the behavior of that lesion and really should be looked for. Signet ring cells themselves automatically are going to make the lesion high-grade and definitely need to be examined. Pseudomyxoma grading, so again, this requires sampling from multiple areas, which we often don't have. Sometimes, and especially for centers that aren't used to dealing with these cases and treating patients like this, or may only do one peritoneal biopsy, whereas what we really need is multiple biopsies, because you may only have one area of the peritoneal disease that actually shows you that high-grade atypia. If you haven't done multiple samples and examined multiple areas, you're not going to be able to diagnose it. And then finally, reporting. Again, I didn't talk about all the old different classification systems, but we really shouldn't be using any of the archaic systems. So these lesions should be reported with WHO terminology and AJCC staging. And once we do that, then the literature and everybody's going to agree on everyone's prognosis and everything for these lesions. And that is all. Thank you.